إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد. We are still explaining the beautiful book by Sheikh عبد الرحمن السعدي, may Allah have mercy upon him, الوسائل المفيدة إلى الحياة السعيدة, the beneficial means to a happy or a tranquil life. And the last means that he explained and talked about, جزاكالله خيرا, was الإكثار من ذكر الله. So he says, ومن أكبر الأسباب لانشراح الصدر وطمأنينته الإكثار من ذكر الله فإن لذلك تأثيرا عجيبا في انشراح الصدر وطمأنينته وزوال همه وغمه. قال تعالى ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. فلذكر الله أثر عظيم في حصول هذا المطلوب لخاصيته ولما يرجوه العبد من ثوابه وأجره. So he's saying one of the biggest means and the most powerful means to achieving tranquility and comfort in the chest or in the heart is to increase in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says this has a very powerful and magical, magnificent impact on the heart, on expanding one's chest and yielding a sense of tranquility and peace. And it does remove and repel the sadness, worries and stress. Then he quotes the verse from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Indeed, in the remembrance or in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the heart will find peace and tranquility. And this is in Surah Ibrahim. So he says, so remembering Allah has a tremendous impact on on arriving at such a state of tranquility and peace. And also, there's another side of it, which is basically when we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're doing this as an act of worship. So we are anticipating or we are expecting reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is another reason that adds more peace to the heart. Now, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is something that I think the majority of Muslims have not really tapped into. They have not really realized the impact of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because most of us do it as lip service. Most of us do it as an exercise of the tongue. But probably the most profound state a human being can ever be in is remembering Allah. The most profound state of existence, state of being a human being can ever be in is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even the most important act of worship that we have in Islam, which is as-salah, which is the pillar of the deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and establish the prayer for my remembrance. So the whole prayer was prescribed and was designed for us to be as a means to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the main point behind salah is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the establishing the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our lives. The reason that we don't really enjoy and reap the fruits of dhikrillah azza wa jal is that we do this at a very superficial level. We do it only with our tongues. We don't experience the real feel of what it means to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to engage in dhikr. Mentioning some examples, actually dhikr has always been an integral part of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, daily routine. All the Muslims, like talking about the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba, the Tabi'een, later generations, the great scholars throughout the ages, remembering Allah or dhikr was always an integral part of their daily activities. It was such an integral part. And I will mention one example from Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah had an hour every day in the morning where he would sit by himself and immerse himself in a state of remembrance. And he would not talk to anyone during that time. And he would not allow anyone to interrupt it for him. Can you keep the door open, Yahya? Yeah, keep it open. Yeah, And he would not allow anyone to interrupt that hour for him or that state for him. And he used to say, هَذِهِ غَدْوَتِي. This is my breakfast. That's my breakfast. إِن لَمْ أَحْصُلْ عَلَيْهَا ضَاعَ يَوْمِي. If I don't get it, my whole day is wasted. Basically, he explains in other places within some of his fatawa, he says, if I don't get that time of seclusion, that time where I'm only by myself connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will waste the rest of my day. I will suffer from lack of focus, and I will not be able to put my effort where I need, and basically the whole day will go to waste. So where does this impact come from? Is it just like as we do, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, just like this? Most of us just, you know, going through the motions. SubhanAllah, 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 SubhanAllah. But these words are so profound, and they are meant for the heart in the first place. The tongue is just a guide. The tongue is just a guide and a vehicle. And a vehicle. So real dhikr is for the heart. And this is why Imam Al-Qayyim says in his book, Al-Wabil Al-Sayyib, he talks about dhikr and he says, the dhikr, real dhikr, is the heart, is in the heart. It's not the tongue. But he says, we have to do it through the tongue because we are human beings. The tongue is mainly the vehicle and the conduit through which we put the heart in that state of remembrance and connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what does it mean to remember Allah? It basically means to take a break from this world. Take a break from the immediate reality. Because we are tending to immediate reality, physical reality, 24/7. And what happens, and this is something we have to understand about humans, we are captives to our perception. We are captives to our perception. And I believe we mentioned some of this previously. What we see is not necessarily the reality, the true reality. It's just a segment of it. And not only that, it's even a distorted segment of reality. So putting your full attention with the immediate reality, with your circumstances or the circumstances of other people, what we call the physical world, will actually work against you. And it will not lead you to the truth. Why? And oftentimes, like we say, let's get real. Yeah, let's get real. Let's talk about what's there. Stop daydreaming, stop, you know, hallucinating. Let's talk about what's there, about the solid facts. Well, that's important, absolutely important. But we're tending to these most of our time. And what happens, we become obsessed with them, and we have an exaggerated or an inaccurate vision of reality. That's the problem. So when you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what you're doing, you're taking a break, so you're detaching from that immediate reality, and you are tapping or you are connecting to a greater reality. And that's the world of the unseen. The world of the unseen. Because, and let me give an example. You see someone, one of your friends, he's usually a very nice person. You see that person, you give him salam today, he says, just leave me alone. And he's upset. You try to help him out, he speaks to you, you know, in an angry, upset kind of mood. And this happens, by the way, mainly between spouses, husband and wife. Straight away we take offense, and we can't, maybe if this is like if this extends over a few days, we say, oh, he's not even a good friend. Why? Because we are captive to the immediate reality, how he's treating us now at the moment. But intelligent people, reasonable people, what they usually do, they analyze. They say, now that's what I see is his negative behavior. But maybe he's going through something. Through some circumstances, right? Maybe he's experiencing some difficulty in his private life, in his personal life, maybe in work or something else that I don't know about. And that has exhausted his willpower and he's completely overwhelmed, and this is why he's unable to be nice. As simple as that. So let me see beyond that. Who's reasonable? The person who takes offense or the person who gives his friend the benefit of the doubt? It's obviously the second one. Why? Because you're tending to something that is beyond the immediate reality. You can see the full context. And that's exactly what we're talking about. The immediate reality is only part of what's there. the real and the full context is basically this reality comes from Allah. It comes from Allah. So when you are connected to Allah and you are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are in a very good position to interpret reality in a better way. You position yourself in an ideal situation where you can expand your perspective and see, you know, or understand at a deeper level what is happening now. And this is why the believers, when things, you know, become bleak and hard for them in their life, things get a bit complicated. This is why they still trust in Allah. They still trust in Allah, although things turn against them. And when you read the literature of success, specifically like biographies of very successful people, you will see that they've been through a lot. They've been through a lot in their life. They've been through some hard times. Some of the rich people, like crazy rich people, at some stage in their life, they were extremely poor and deprived. And there were people like who were a complete failure in whatever they did. But now they are a great success in their field. If you, when you read their biographies, you see a recurring pattern that these people, during the low times, during the hard times, they maintained a belief that something else is going to happen. And things will just get better. And where do they get their belief? It's just trust. It's their trust. And by the way, you might say, these are, you know, non-Muslims. How do they get this? How do they get this? And I had this question for a few years until I read a few years back a statement from Ibn Taymiyyah, and then it was also quoted by his student Ibn al-Qayyim. Basically, when he talks about the types of people with regards to belief and tawakkul, he says people are four types. There are people who have belief and love for Allah, and they rely on Him. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. He says these are the most perfect among humans. And he says there are people who worship Allah, love Him, and they are devout to Him, but they don't perform tawakkul properly. They don't trust in Allah. So these people are very hardworking, and they only believe in cause and effect, period. That's all they believe in. So they don't really trust so much in Allah, but they're so focused on the dynamics, physical dynamics of the world. And there's a third type of, and he says these people will still, if they maintain their belief in Allah, still enter paradise. But they have missed out on a great aspect of worship, and that's trust in Allah and tawakkul, or reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third type of people, he said, these are people, and these are the worst. They don't believe in Allah, they don't love Allah, and they don't rely on Allah. They just don't believe in Allah, they don't care. So for them, they're immersed in the physical world, everything for them is 1 + 1 = 2, okay, the cause and effect equation. But he says there are people who don't love Allah, don't believe, like don't have faith in Him, but they depend on some force. They depend on some force that controls the universe and that helps them. So these people don't have iman, but they have tawakkul. That's interesting, right? People don't believe in Allah. And actually, I was surprised to see some non-Muslims, they don't really believe Allah is there, or they have some kind of strange beliefs about Allah and about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But these people, they do trust. They say, there is a force, or there is a power in this universe, that if you trust in it, and if you believe in it, that it will help you, it will end up helping you. And that's very common, by the way. This is very common. So Ibn Taymiyyah talked about this, and he solved the problem that I was like, how can someone, you know, trust something but they don't believe in Allah? But it's there. So remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us transcend the immediate reality and see where it's coming from. See where it's coming from. So when we fall in hardship, we know that's not the end of the world. We know this is not the whole story of our lives. This is just one stage within our lives. We know that everything is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if it's happening, if it's hard for me, I know where it's coming from. It's coming from Allah. He's merciful, He's wise, He's knowledgeable, and He takes care of His creation. So He must have, there must be wisdom. There must be a reason why Allah is allowing this to happen. If something good happens to me, I don't say like Qarun, you know, from Bani Israel, when Allah gave him so much wealth, he said, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. I was given it because of my own merit and my own knowledge and my own skill. That's my wealth. The wealth that I have was my own work. No one has any favor upon me. Allah hasn't given me a favor. That's my hard work. That's it. But the believer knows that when Allah gives you something good, you know it's a gift from Allah. So you also see where it's coming from. So your sight and your heart are not only limited to the physical world, but you see what's beyond it. And that's the most powerful tool to help you achieve this. A lot of people say, how can I achieve tawakkul? Tawakkul, by the way, is not a state of mind. It's not a state of mind. It's a state of heart. It's that you believe and you trust when everything is sending you the opposite message. You know, things will work out and things will be good because you put your trust in Allah. Although everything you see and everything you hear is giving you the message that everything is just falling apart. That's what trust is. And this is why Al-Hasan bin Ali radiyallahu anhu, he said, alaykum salam, he said, التوكل أن تكون لما في يد الله أوثق مما في يدك. And that's a profound statement. أن تكون لما في يد الله أوثق مما في يدك. He says that you trust what's in the hands of Allah. That means that hasn't come to you yet, more than you trust what you already possess in your hands. Make sense? Do you get the point? He says that you trust what Allah will give you, which He hasn't given you yet, more than, and you have no doubt, you have no fear about it, you trust it, you're so sure it's going to happen, Allah will give it to you and Allah will take care of you, more than you possess the money that you have in your account or in your hands. You're more sure of that, which has not come yet, more than you are sure and of the money that you already have. They already possess and you can see it physically. So trust and tawakkul is a state of heart, it's not a state of mind. Because the mind only works with what the senses give it. What the senses give it. So only what you see. When you don't see it, when you don't hear it, you can't touch it, it's not there yet, you don't believe in it. You don't trust it. But the heart transcends that. So it knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let you down. And if believers collectively reach a high level of this, they become unbeatable. They become invincible, unstoppable. And that's exactly what happened in the Battle of Badr. In the Battle of Badr. And Muslims throughout the time, that for them was the case. That's for them was the case. And this extends from the Qudusi Hadith, which is the divine hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's reported by Al-Bukhari. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي فَلْيَظُنَّ عَبْدِي بِي مَا شَاءَ. The second part is in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. I am to my servant as he thinks of me. What do you think? What does your heart feel about Allah? That's how Allah will treat you. So you trust Allah will take care of you. Allah will make things work out for you. Allah will not let you down. It will happen. It will happen, but the difficulty is in getting into that state of heart. And how can you get there? With dhikr. When you make dhikr, not only with your tongue, but with your heart. With your heart. And the sweetest act of worship, the sweetest act of worship is remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when you do it with your tongue, it becomes a tedious task. It's just, you know, doing something that's meaningless. What's the point of saying subhanAllah, 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 subhanAllah? It's like a burden, man. I need to keep saying this. But when it's a complete holistic state that's coming from your heart and it's engaging your mind and your thoughts and your tongue is expressing it, you can't even stop it. You don't want to stop it. You don't even want to talk to people because you're talking to Allah. So you're having what we call al-ma'iyyah. You are feeling your connection to Allah, that Allah is with you. That Allah is with you. You feel the companionship of Allah with you. You feel it. So you don't want to substitute that with anything else. Why do you want to be with people or in the company of people when you are in the company of Allah? And that's what سفيان الثوري said, والله إنه لتمر بالقلب لحظات أقول فيها لو كان أهل الجنة في مثل هذا لكفاهم. He says, sometimes I go through moments that I say, if the people in paradise, that's the beauty they get in paradise, that's good enough. That's good enough. The sweetness, the beauty, the tranquility, and the peace. Which moments these are? Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why also one of the tabi'een says, مَسَاكِينٌ أَهْلُ الدُّنْيَا خَرَجُوا مِنْهَا وَمَا ذَاقُوا أَطْيَبَ مَا فِيهَا مَعْرِفَةُ اللَّهِ وَذِكْرُهُ وَالْأُنْسُ بِهِ وَالشَّوْقُ إِلَى لِقَائِهِ. He says, pathetic and poor are the people of this dunya. They've come into this world and they left it, they departed. That means they lived the whole course of their life without, or having missed, they went through the whole years of their life, the whole lifespan, having missed the sweetest thing, the sweetest experience in this life, on this earth. And this is knowing Allah, remembering Him, mentioning His name, feeling His companionship, and longing to His meeting, looking forward to His meeting. That's the sweetest. Where does this come? Why am I elaborating in such a way? Because that's what dhikr gives you, if you do it well. If you do it well. So when you're saying subhanAllah, this should take you into a completely different world. Completely different world. So the dhikr, remember, is not only for the tongue. It's not only, even the scholars have disputed. There's a huge, by the way, dispute that's been going on for more than 1,000 years. That if someone recites Quran or makes dhikr, like says subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, but they don't focus. They don't even focus in it. They're not experiencing it fully. Are they getting reward or not? Are they getting reward or not? That's a huge debate among the scholars. And I personally side with the fact that if someone is just saying it, they don't get anything. You don't get anything because that's for the heart. And it's not even the dhikr. Some of the scholars have disputed even your salah. If you're not experiencing it, if you're not fully focused and experiencing that beauty, that sweetness of salah, it might not be accepted. And some scholars, like Imam al-Ghazali, he even says that it's not even accepted, you have to repeat it. Because Allah says, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. Establish the prayer for my remembrance, so that you remember me. What remembers Allah? Your heart. Your heart remembers Allah. So this can only happen when you engage in dhikr in a full state. I find it really like disturbing to see like some of the Buddhists or the Hindus or some of these new age spiritual people which has become a trend. They get into meditation, yoga, and they repeat mantras, etc. And they get into a state of focus when we Muslims have better tools. We have better tools like the prayer and the remembrance of Allah, and we're not even experiencing it. The other day someone told me, someone from my country, he studies medicine in the US. And he goes to one of these top universities. I can't remember, it's either Harvard or MIT, one of these Ivy League universities. And he finished his course and he came first, so he received an award. And the award was a course, a treatment and a course in India that costs around $100,000. It's for 4 days. And top people, CEOs of companies, rich people, they actually joined that trip or that course. So he said, we went there and he said, like, it blew my mind. It blew my mind because we went into some rural area in India and there was these like Hindu priests or hermits, and simply they just gave us a daily routine and they supervised it. And the daily routine was to sit in a cave and try to hold your breath for as long as you can, and then once you can't hold it anymore, you take deep breath for about a minute, and so on and so forth. And when do you start? 3 o'clock in the morning, 3 a.m. And then you take a break for 1 hour where you sit in nature, either by the ocean or by a river or in the woods, and you just do what they call meditation, which is basically trying to silence your thoughts. Just don't think of anything. Don't think of anything. Slow down your mind. So they do this 3 times every day. And he said, for 4 days. And that's what we do. And he says, like, the feedback I get from these people, like, they say, thank you so much for such a beautiful experience. And he says, Allah, what if you guys know about what we Muslims, what we are meant to do? We are meant to wake up and make Qiyam al-Layl. We're meant to wake up and make Salat al-Fajr. And then remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do the Adhkar al-Sabah wal-Masa', the remembrance of the morning and the evening. But we go through the motions, we don't realize. We don't realize how profound these are as an experience. We don't realize how powerful these are actually. They are. They're life-changing experiences. You know why? Because it taps into your heart. It taps into something you know. It awakens your fitrah. It awakens your fitrah and puts you in control, puts you on top of your life. So your mind, your brain doesn't spin like crazy, trying to chase everything in this life, the demands of life, and the expectations and so on and so forth. No. You know, there is time to, you know, tend to whatever you need to tend to, but you know there's a bigger purpose behind life. And you know, and it gives you that calm and that peace. The calm and peace doesn't come from your mind. It can never come from your mind, because your mind is just designed as a thinking machine. It's designed to help you survive in this world and make a life here. The peace and tranquility come from the heart. The love comes from the heart. It comes from, it's your soul. It's your soul. So this peace is the nature of the soul. Is the nature of the soul. So what helps you tap into this? A lot of people say, how can I become like more spiritual? How can I find the sweetness of salah? How can I find this sweetness? How can I connect to Allah? How can I overcome my problems? I can't stop thinking. I'm experiencing stress and anxiety and fear and worry and all of these. And all of this is driving me crazy. What can I do? All you can do is tap into your soul that knows Allah. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you remember Allah, your tongue is reminding your soul. And there are 3 levels that you ascend through. First, dhikr will start as a tongue practice. If you pay attention to it and try to contemplate the words and not think of anything else. Because when you think, you're stressing about things. So not think, only remember the words of Allah and see where they take you. Say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allah, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. Feel it, feel the words. Say it as if you mean it. Slowly, slowly, that's the beginning. Is when you say and you try to focus, but it's not having that impact. But if you keep trying over and over again, you move on to the second level. The second level is when you say it with your tongue, your mind reflects on it and your heart feels it. And that's a beautiful state to be in. So the more and more and more you do it, you will be surprised that you will move on to the higher level. And the higher level is remembrance will be in your heart. And your heart will remind your tongue. So your tongue becomes a tool to express what's in your heart. So you started first from external, from your mouth, into the inside, from outside in. And then you reach a level where it's a balance between outside and inside. And then you come to a place where the whole process becomes inside out. It comes from your heart. And you find your tongue just moving with the remembrance of Allah. Why? Because it wants to express the beauty that you feel in your heart. And that's when remembrance or dhikr starts to change your life. And that's why now Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'd is saying one of the greatest means to a happy and tranquil life is dhikr. You see why? See why? Because dhikr is not only just the tongue murmuring certain words or repeating certain words. It's a holistic experience, a profound experience. And if you miss out on it, I said, this is the sweetest act of worship. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ, one of the companions came to me and said, Ya Rasulullah, inna sha'air al-Islami kathurat alay. O Messenger of Allah, you know, the rituals and the demands and the things to learn and remember and deal with in Islam have become so much. It seems that he was probably an old person, or he didn't have such a strong memory. He became overwhelmed. So he said, فأخبرني بأمر أتمسك به جامع. So tell me of something that is central and very basic and pivotal, that when I hold on to it, that's enough for me. The Prophet ﷺ says, لا يزال لسانك رطبا من ذكر الله. Let your tongue remain or be moist with the remembrance of Allah. Now the Prophet ﷺ obviously is not talking only about the tongue, because when we say remembrance of Allah, the Prophet ﷺ is talking about the whole experience. The whole experience. So that's why remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually a means to a tranquil and happy life. Another reason he shares here, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ التَّحَدُّثُ بِنَعَمِ اللَّهِ الظَّاهِرَةِ وَالْبَاطِنَةِ فَإِنَّ مَعْرِفَتَهَا وَالتَّحَدُّثَ بِهَا يَدْفَعُ اللَّهُ بِهِ الْهَمَّ وَالْغَمْ وَيَحُثُّ الْعَبْدَ عَلَى الشُّكْرِ الَّذِي هُوَ أَرْفَعُ الْمَرَاتِبِ وَأَعْلَاهَا حَتَّى وَلَوْ كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي حَالَةِ فَقْرٍ أَوْ مَرَضٍ أَوْ غَيْرِهِمَا مِنْ أَنْوَاعِ الْبَلَايَا فَإِنَّهُ إِذَا قَابَلَ بَيْنَ نِعَمِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ الَّتِي لَا يُحْصَى لَهَا عَدٌّ وَلَا حِسَابٌ وَبَيْنَ مَا أَصَابَهُ مِنْ مَكْرُوهٍ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِلْمَكْرُوهِ إِلَى النِّعَمِ نِسْبَةٌ. He says, another reason or another means to a happy life is to acknowledge and talk about the blessings of Allah, the ones that are so apparent and the ones that are hidden and taken for granted. He says, acknowledging them and talking about them is a means through which Allah repels worry, sadness, and anxiety. And it also gets you to the state of shukr and thankfulness, gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the reason most of us are not doing thankfulness, are not engaged in thankfulness, is because we are not even acknowledging, we're not even thinking about how many blessings Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. We're so busy thinking about the negative things in our lives, the things that went wrong, although they might be small in number. And this is what he's talking about. So he says, and this pushes the person into the level of shukr, or the state of shukr, which is one of the highest levels and ranks in religion. And he says, even if the person is in a state of poverty and lack or illness or any other trial and hardship, if the person compares the blessings of Allah on one side, that are countless, to the number of pains and hardships and ailments the person is going through, there will be no comparison. There's no ratio, because the blessings are far, far more greater than the hardships and the trials that we are going through. So once we realize this, you know, this kind of mistake or error in perception, because mostly we're leaning to focus on what's going wrong, mainly on what is causing us some hardship and some discomfort. So we exaggerate it. Our minds blow it out of proportion and we give it so much weight. And the problem is, our mind can create our reality. If the mind focuses on something, and focus or attention is a very limited resource. So when your mind focuses on something, and that's what it focuses on, it seems like this is your whole reality. It neglects the rest of the things that you're not focusing on. This is why it's important to train your focus. Always focus on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored you with. Then he says, بَلْ الْمَكْرُوهُ وَالْمَصَائِبِ إِذَا ابْتَلَى اللَّهُ بِهَا الْعَبْدُ وَأَدَّى فِيهَا وَظِيفَةَ الصَّبْرِ وَالْرِضَى وَالتَّسْلِيمِ هَانَتْ وَطْأَتُهَا وَخَفَّتْ مُؤْنَتُهَا وَكَانَ تَأْمِيلُ الْعَبْدِ لِأَجْرِهَا وَثَوَابِهَا وَالتَّعَبُّدِ لِلَّهِ بِالْقِيَامِ بِوَظِيفَةِ الصَّبْرِ وَالرِّضَى يَدَعُ الْأَشْيَاءَ الْمُرَّةَ حُلْوَى فَتُنْسِيهِ حَلَاوَةُ أَجْرِهَا مَرَارَةَ صَبْرِهَا. This is beautiful. He says, even hardships and trials, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries His servant with these hardships, if the person holds on to patience and treats or faces these conditions with patience, contentment, acceptance of what Allah has caused to happen, and letting go, at-tasleem, hanat wat'atuha, you will be surprised that these hardships would be lessened. Their impact would be greatly lessened and would be watered down. وَخَفَّتْ مُؤْنَتُهَا, and would become, you know, its weight will almost, you know, be taken away. وَكَانَ تَأْمِيلُ الْعَبْدِ لِأَجْرِهَا وَثَوَابِ, and this person would hope for reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reward for his patience. Reward for being patient and being content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings into his life. And he says this is a great act of worship. He says the fruit of this, that it will turn the bitterness of the trial into the sweetness of patience. So instead of bitterness, you will experience sweetness. And this sweetness will be so strong that will cause you to forget about the bitterness of your experience. And again, this could only happen to someone, to a heart that is connected to Allah, that is able to transcend the immediate reality. But if you keep yourself captive to the immediate reality, that's your choice, but you will suffer. You can't transcend it. You can't transcend it. Then he shows the technique that follows from this means, and he says, وَمِنْ أَنْفَعِ الْأَشْيَاءِ فِي هَذَا الْمَوْضِعِ اسْتِعْمَالُ مَا أَرْشَدَ إِلَيْهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي الْحَدِيثِ الصَّحِيحِ حَيْثُ قَالَ انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم ولا تنظروا إلى من هو فوقكم فإنه أجدر ألا تزدروا نعمة الله عليكم. Reported by Al-Bukhari, by Muslim and others. He guides us to an advice from the Prophet ﷺ to help us do this, where the Messenger ﷺ says, look at the people or focus on the people that are lower than you in matters of dunya, people who have less than you have. وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَكُمْ. Don't focus or don't look at people who are in a better state than you. Then he explains, فَإِنَّهُ أَجْدَرُ أَلَّا تَزْدَرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. He says, this is more likely, or this will help you, you know, not to look down upon the blessings of Allah upon you. Because whatever Allah has given you, when you see someone who's enjoying more, you'll take what you have for granted and it will become meaningless. You won't appreciate it. You won't. And the only time we appreciate it is when it's taken away. When it's taken away, then, oh, we miss it. We realize how much we have been blessed, or we were blessed. He says, فَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا نَصَبَ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ هَذَا الْمَلْحَظَ الْجَلِيلِ رَآهُ يَفُوقُ قَطْعًا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْخَلْقِ فِي الْعَافِيَةِ وَتَوَابِعِهَا وَفِي الرِّزْقِ وَتَوَابِعِهِ مَهْمَا بَلَغَتْ بِهِ الْحَالِ فَيَزُولُ قَلَقُهُ وَهَمُّهُ وَغَمُّهُ وَيَزْدَادُ سُرُورُهُ وَاغْتِبَاطُهُ بِنِعَمِ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَاقَ فِيهَا غَيْرَهُ مِمَّنْ هُوَ دُونَهُ فِيهَا. So he says, when the person focuses on implementing the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would realize, or she would realize, that they are actually far better than others, far better than others in terms of health and in terms of provision, in terms of the financial state, regardless of how painful or how miserable his or her state is. He says this will lead to removing the worry, the stress and the sadness, and this will increase the happiness and peace and tranquility and appreciation of Allah's blessings upon that person. Then he says, وَكُلَّمَا طَالَ تَأَمُّلُ الْعَبْدِ بِنِعَمِ اللَّهِ الظَّاهِرَةِ وَالْبَاطِنَةِ الدِّينِيَّةِ وَالدُّنْيَوِيَّةِ رَأَى رَبَّهُ قَدْ أَعْطَاهُ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا وَدَفَعَ عَنْهُ شُرُورًا مُتَعَدِّدًا وَلَا شَكَّ أَنَّ هَذَا يَدْفَعُ الْهُمُومَ وَالْغُمُومَ وَيُوجِبُ الْفَرَحَ وَالسُّرُورَ. He says, and the more the person contemplates these blessings of Allah, whether they are apparent and clear or they are hidden and taken for granted, whether they pertain to this dunya and to this life, or they pertain even to matters of the deen. Because being blessed with faith and iman and knowledge about Allah is such a huge blessing. So he says, the person would realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored him and has given him so much. And Allah has taken away or has pushed away from him so many harms and pains and discomfort. And no doubt this repels anxiety and pain and brings about happiness and tranquility. Then he shares another means. Before I move on, does anyone have any questions about something we said? If not, I'll move on. If you have questions, we'll try to deal with them. Yeah.
When we say the heart.
Hearts, yes. This is an old debate. Is the physical heart the real heart that we talk about in religious matters? And is it the same heart that we talk about when it comes to love? Now, we have to admit first, the heart is a mystery, even in science. Even in science until today, the heart is a mystery. Because I believe in neuroscience, they say that the heart, each cell in the heart has its own brain. And the heart has some intelligence. But still, in neuroscience and neurology, they're still trying to study this, but there's not so much advancement. The advancement has mainly been in neuroscience when it comes to the brain, brain cells, and the chemistry of the brain, and the state of the brain, and which parts of the brain are responsible for what, and so on and so forth. But there is something strange about the heart that still has not been investigated fully yet. There's so much to learn about. There has been a few studies about heart transplant cases, and some of them are actually mind-blowing. The person essentially would still be the same when they receive another heart, but some things, I will get you to say something, inshallah, but there are strange things that happen. There are strange things that happen to the person who takes the heart of another one, So some memory is stored there, some personal characteristics are stored there, seem to be stored there. And just some of the examples that I remember, there was a child that received a heart transplant because of a child that died in an accident. Now usually, the two families of both kids, they do not know each other. These are the rules in the medical world, because they don't want issues to happen. Oh, that child has got the heart of our own child. You know, especially that these things are not so widespread, still, like heart transplant is not so widespread. So they're very careful, they're monitoring, you know, what happens socially, emotionally, etc. They want to see what happens, they want to know what happens. So one case that I read about is that accidentally, probably, although there's no accidents in this world, there's no accident in this world. Everything happens for a reason and it's been pre-planned. They go to the same church, both families. And they don't know each other. So the father of the child who received the heart says, we went to the church and our son, who was like probably 5 years old or 6 years old, as we walk into the church, he sees a man and a woman, he runs to them and he hugs them and gives them so many he's kissing them and hugging them, and he spent that service with them. And we were surprised, we've never seen these people, they're strangers. And they seem to love my son so much. So we got to know the families, then we found out these are the parents of the child who died in the accident, and he's the donor of the heart. So that's surprising. There was also incidents of sexual orientation. So when someone received the heart of someone who had a different sexual orientation, it actually affected their own sexual behavior. But these studies are still in the early stages, there's not much evidence, etc. You said you had something to share. Really?
Yeah.
SubhanAllah.
There was another guy that he...
Yes.
Heart transplant. And so the guy that he took the new heart was non-Muslim.
Yeah.
And the guy that he was given, so he was Muslim. So the guy that he got it, he started pronouncing like words from Muslim words like Astaghfirullah and things like that.
SubhanAllah.
Who am I? And it's proven physically that it's...
Are they Arab? Is he Arab? Not even Arab.
No, South
Africa. SubhanAllah.
And it's proven that the heart that he asked about,
SubhanAllah.
It's a real heart.
SubhanAllah. So the heart that someone received or took from a donor who passed away, the donor was a Muslim. So the one who received the heart was a non-Muslim. So he found himself saying statements that usually Muslims say, SubhanAllah, Astaghfirullah, things like that. That's surprising. So anyway, the debate, let's take it old in history. Muslim scholars have had a debate. Is the heart the physical heart, or is the heart just a pump?
What is the soul?
Huh?
What is the soul?
Now that's, it's not as easy as that, because the scholars are agreed, like Al-Ghazali mentions in Ihya Ulumuddin, and that's something that Ibn Taymiyyah confirms. He says the heart is not necessarily a physical thing that we talk about in Islam. It's not necessarily a physical thing. It has to do with the soul, but it's absolutely connected to the physical heart. But it doesn't have to be the same. Doesn't have to. So it's connected, strongly connected, and it has a lot to do with the soul. It has a lot to do with the soul. Some scholars say, no, the heart that we talk about in religious, within a religious like meaning, has nothing to do with the physical heart. But that's actually not the case. At least I take this opinion. There is a strong connection. There is a strong connection. So, basically we have to see the connection between these things. The heart, the soul, and the fitrah. These things are connected, and sometimes they are used interchangeably. So one is used to refer to the other. Heart, soul, and fitrah. Heart, soul, and fitrah. And also sometimes a nafs is used for that. But a nafs could be sometimes separate, because it's sometimes used for something else. So is the heart the same? We don't know exactly, but we know for sure it's connected. We know for sure it's connected. The heart, the heart we talk about in a religious sense, is absolutely connected to the physical heart. Because even the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, أَلَا وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً. The Prophet ﷺ says, there is a morsel of flesh in the body that when it's sound and intact, the whole body is sound and intact. The Prophet ﷺ is not talking about health here. He's talking about deeds. So absolutely there is a strong connection between the heart in a religious sense and the physical heart. There is. What is exactly this connection? This is a mystery. This is a mystery. So Ibn Taymiyyah believes, and this is a profound, by the way, that's a profound realization happening 700 years ago. He believes the heart has the belief and the faith and the emotions, and he believes the brain translates this into worldly terms. So to put it in modern language, he says the brain is the secretary of the heart. And he says they are strongly connected. They're strongly connected. And now the most advances in neuroscience are actually pointing towards something like this. They are pointing towards something like this. This is why they even approve of some scientific articles and scientific journals are actually using things, gut intelligence. You know, we say, I know it in my gut. I feel it in my gut. Actually, science now is actually leaning towards this, that there is some truth in this. There is some truth in this. And that love in all cultures is in the heart. Now, neuroscience is saying, no, it's all chemistry in the brain. But a lot of neurologists are actually questioning this. That's only one aspect of the experience of love. There is absolutely some activity happening in the brain. But what about, but there's something else as well, something else that is happening. So it's not only the chemistry of the brain, there are other things that are happening in the heart and in the gut as well. So we don't know exactly, it's a mystery. It's a mystery. But still, it doesn't necessarily have practical consequences for us. So keep in mind, the heart, the soul, and the fitrah are very strongly connected. These things are very strongly connected. And does the heart and the soul, do they have a connection to the physical heart? Yes, they do have a connection to the heart, but this, what exactly this connection is a mystery. We don't know, because this is now, we're bordering on the world of the soul, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنَ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوْتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. They ask you about the ruh, about the soul, about the spirit. Tell them that's one of the matters that Allah has kept for Himself. That knowledge, Allah kept it for Himself, and you have only been given very little of knowledge. Okay. Any more questions? More questions? Yes.
So talking about remembrance of Allah.
Yeah.
Can that be done in any language? Does it have to be just Arabic? For example, if you want to say Alhamdulillah instead of saying Alhamdulillah.
Okay.
If you end up saying thanks to Allah, thank you Allah, or something like that.
We have to differentiate first. If it's remembrance after Salah, Subhanallah, 33 times, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Allahu Akbar 33 times. No, you say it in Arabic. But it's simple. You know the meanings of these words. If not, you can learn them. In 5 minutes, you can learn them. But if it's random dhikr, you want to just make random dhikr, you can make it in your own language. But I would still recommend doing it in Arabic. I would still recommend doing it in Arabic. Because, by the way, the reason Allah chose the Arabic language for the Quran was not also random. Some people say, oh, because it will be preserved. Well, yes, it will be preserved. And one of the strongest reasons it was preserved, that the Quran was revealed in it. So the Quran probably is the reason why the Arabic language was preserved in the first place, not the other way around. So why did Allah choose the Arabic language? There's something special about the Arabic language. And there are narrations indicating that even the language of the people in paradise is the Arabic language. So the Arabic language has a connection to the heart. It has something special about the soul. So it penetrates. And that's why Allah chose it to be in Arabic. This is why Allah still chose the Salah to be still in Arabic.
So when you make prayers in any language other than Arabic, will they get accepted?
Definitely you will get some reward because you're remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Definitely you will get some reward, absolutely. Yeah. But what I would recommend is that you get used. Even people who never had no exposure to Arabic, people who came to Islam later on, and they learned these adhkar, they still get a full experience of what it means to do dhikr in Arabic. So it's just a matter of getting your mind used to it. The heart will recognize it. The heart will recognize it. Yeah. Because the meanings in other languages are just interpretation, translation. But these words of Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, they came in the Quran and in the Sunnah. They came from a divine link. They came to you, they arrived to you. So this is why it's definitely recommended to do it in Arabic, and you need just to get used to that. And the meaning is not in the exact, not necessarily the wording or the letters. These are just, they remind your heart of something. So there's a spiritual reality that these words are reminding you of. So the language is not really that important. But Arabic absolutely comes first and has more. It's more recommended, absolutely. When it comes to random dhikr, I'm talking about random dhikr. But the prescribed dhikr, what you have to do after salah or certain places, or even morning and evening, all these dhikr, no, you do them as they came from the Prophet ﷺ. Once you get over the issue of language and language barrier, the Arabic is much better. And what is more important is the meaning that's in the heart. The meaning that's in the heart. So if you transcend the language barrier, that's better. So do it in Arabic, that would be my recommendation. But I would say if you do it in any other language and you feel it in your heart, if it's random dhikr, absolutely, you must be getting some reward from it. More questions? No questions? Anyway, so it's time for Salat al-Isha. Jazakumullah khairan for your attendance and your attention. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.